During my holidays, I walked in a tropical rainwood in Honduras. It's quite humid in such areas, and the water flows along your face. Although this is not comfortable, the rainwood itself has a beautiful flora and fauna. On the other side, when I visited Death Valley in USA, it feels warm and dry, but not immediately uncomfortable. Nevertheless, you have to take care that you drink enough, because otherwise your body dehydrates. Can we understand these two situations on the basis of the knowledge of transport phenomena? If we look more carefully to these situations, we see that we have to deal with a simultaneous process of heat and mass transfer. You all know the feeling when you have just taken a shower and you switch off the water, immediately the droplets at your body start to evaporate and your body cools down. Typically a matter of mass transfer. But given the heat necessary for the evaporation of the droplets, also heat transport. Can we describe this process on the basis of our current knowledge? Let's look at a droplet on your body. The approaching air is dry. In the beginning, the temperature of the water droplet is the same temperature as the airflow. But quite soon you feel that your body becomes colder. This is the result of evaporation of the water droplet. The resulting steady state temperature of the water droplet is called the wet bulb temperature. Let's now look how we can approach this evaporation process of a droplet in an airflow. We assume here that only a small amount is evaporated and that the diameter of the water droplets remains practically constant. Setting up a mass balance and an energy balance of the droplet, we obtain a relationship between the heat flow, phi q, and the product of the mass flow rate, phi m, and the heat evaporation, delta h. The heat necessary for the evaporation is delivered by the air. This means that heat is transferred from the air to the droplet. This can be described by the following relationship, where h is the heat transfer coefficient, a the surface of the droplet, T infinite the temperature of the air, and T zero the wet bulb temperature of the water droplet. On the other side, water is evaporated from the droplet surface into the air. Around the droplet, the air is saturated with water and the water vapor is transferred from the surface into the airstream. The resulting mass flow can now be described in terms of the driving force delta C and the mass transfer coefficient K. In this equation, C star is the concentration of water in the saturated air around the droplet, and C infinite the concentration of water present in the air. If we assume that water vapor is an ideal gas, we can rewrite this equation into the following formula, where m is the molar mass of water, p star the vapor pressure of the air near the surface of the droplet, and p infinite for the vapor pressure of the incoming gas. For the value of T in this equation, usually the mean of T infinite and T zero is taken. We have now expressions for the simultaneous transport of heat and mass transfer of the water droplet in the airflow. One for the heat flow, an expression for the heat transfer between the air and the water droplet, and for the mass transfer from the droplet surface to the air. Combining all these equations gives us the following relationship. To solve this equation, we need information about the heat transfer coefficient H and the mass transfer coefficient K. We already know the correlations for the heat transfer coefficient H and the mass transfer coefficient K of a flow around the sphere. Substituting these correlations, we obtain the following relationship between H over K. If the Reynolds number is not too small in this equation, we obtain, thanks to Chilton and Colburn, an expression for the ratio of the heat transfer coefficient and the mass transfer coefficient in terms of the density, the heat capacity, and the Lewis number. Combining this expression with the previous results gives us the following relationship. Actually, this is an equation with two unknown quantities. That means the wetted bulb temperature, T0, and the vapor pressure, P star, which is a function of the temperature. Generally, the vapor pressure as a function of the temperature is known and can be found in handbooks or scientific literature. Let's look at the following example. We have an airflow of 20 degrees Celsius, which contains a certain amount of water. What is the relative humidity of the air in this situation? The relative humidity is defined as the ratio of the pressure of the vapor in a gas mixture divided by the saturation pressure of the vapor at the same temperature. In our case, P infinite divided by P star. So if we measure the wetted bulb temperature T0 in an airflow with a temperature of 20 degrees Celsius, we are able to calculate relative humidity. In this case, the thermometer indicates a wet bulb temperature of T0 of 6 degrees Celsius. We know that the vapor pressure of water P star at 6 degrees Celsius is equal to 935 pascals. If we now substitute all the other fluid properties, we can calculate P infinite. We find a value of 2337 pascal. This gives us a relative humidity of 39%. In many drying and humidity relations fields, we also speak about the absolute humidity, which is defined as kilograms of vapor in a gas per kilograms of dry gas, and the dew point, which is the temperature at which condensation starts when humid gas is cooled down, or in other words, the temperature at which the gas is saturated with vapor. To determine the humidity or the dew point of an airflow, one often uses a so-called humidity chart at a pressure of 1 bar. But how do we use this humidity chart? This can be illustrated by an example. What are the absolute and relative humidity of an air with a temperature of 70 degrees Celsius with a wet bulb temperature of 55 degrees Celsius? We will move along the adiabatic cooling line to the right to 70 degrees Celsius and see that the absolute humidity is 0.105 kilograms water per kilogram dry air. And we also see that the relative humidity is 49%. Cooling the air increases the relative humidity while the absolute humidity stays constant. In this chart, we can see that air with an absolute humidity of 0.105 kilogram of water per kilogram of dry air is saturated at 53.7 degrees Celsius. This is the so-called dew point where condensation of water starts. Realize that in many industrial applications, it is important to know the humidity of air of gas. Think about air-conditioned buildings or industrial cooling towers. And when you bring a visit to a tropical rainwood, please think about this course on transport phenomena. Thanks for watching this video.